we realize that there perhaps isn't much we can do as individuals to change the pattern of behavior in a world around us, but encourage us to be agents of light, to be agents of love in those places of the world that we frequent. Help us to light a candle rather than to curse the darkness. And we lift up before you in the silence of our hearts those concerns that we can only bring to you there. For the things we have named aloud and for those things which each of us have brought before you in the silence of our hearts, we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Those who are able may stand for the singing of the hymn, The Church's One Foundation.
Jesus Christ, the Lord.
Our reading from Hebrew Scripture this morning comes to us from the book of Genesis, the 12th chapter, verses 1 through 4a. Now the Lord said to Abram, "Go from your country and your kindred and your father's house to the land that I will show you. I will make of you a great nation, and I will bless you and make your name great, so that you will be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you, and the one who curses you I will curse. And in you all the families of the earth shall be blessed." So Abram went as the Lord had told him. Our epistle lesson comes to us from Paul's letter to the Romans, the 4th chapter, verses 1 through 5 and verses 13 through 17. "What then are we to say that was gained by Abraham, our ancestor according to the flesh? For if Abraham was justified by works, he has something to boast about, but not before God. For what does the Scripture say? Abraham believed God, and it was reckoned to him as righteousness. Now to one who works, wages are not reckoned as a gift, but as something due. But to the one who without works trusts him, who justifies the ungodly, such faith is reckoned to him as righteousness. For the promise that he would inherit the world did not come to Abraham or to his descendants through the law, but through the righteousness of faith. If it is the adherents of the law who are to be heirs, faith is null and the promise is void. For the law brings wrath, but where there is no law, neither is there violation. For this reason it depends on faith, in order that the promise may rest on grace and be guaranteed to all his descendants, not only to the adherents of the law, but also to those who share the faith of Abraham, for he is the father of us all. As it is written, 'I have made you the father of many nations, in the presence of the God in whom he believed, who gives life to the dead and calls into existence the things that do not exist.'" And our gospel lesson and the text for the message today comes to us from John's Gospel, the 3rd chapter, verses 1 through 17. "Now there was a Pharisee named Nicodemus, a leader of the Jews. He came to Jesus by night and said to him, 'Rabbi, we know that you are a teacher who has come from God, for no one can do these signs that you do apart from the presence of God.' Jesus answered him, 'Very truly I tell you, no one can see the kingdom of God without being born from above.' Nicodemus said to him, 'How can anyone be born after having grown old? Can one enter a second time into the mother's womb and be born?' Jesus answered, 'Very truly I tell you, no one can enter the kingdom of God without being born of water and spirit. What is born of the flesh is flesh, and what is born of the Spirit is spirit. Do not be astonished that I said to you, you must be born from above. The wind blows where it chooses, and you hear the sound of it, but you do not know where it comes from or where it goes. So it is with everyone who is born of the Spirit.' Nicodemus said to him, 'How can these things be?' Jesus answered him, 'Are you a teacher of Israel, and yet you do not understand these things? Very truly, I tell you, we speak of what we know and testify to what we have seen, yet you do not receive our testimony. If I have told you about earthly things and you do not believe, how can you believe if I tell you about heavenly things? No one has ascended into heaven except the one who has descended from heaven, the Son of Man. And just as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, so must the Son of Man be lifted up, that whoever believes in him may have eternal life. For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, so that everyone who believes in him may not perish, but may have eternal life. Indeed, God did not send the Son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through him." Thus ends the reading of our Scripture. May God add a blessing to our hearing of it. We now continue with a selection from our chancel choir, "The King of Love, My Shepherd Is." Thank you, Chancel Choir, for sharing the gift of music with us this morning. If it is the fall of the year, and I happen to be in one of the stores, and I happen to see young persons, probably under voting age, and almost always, invariably, young men, picking up multi-pack rolls of this sort of thing, I know that it's got to be homecoming week either in Plymouth or Elkhart Lake. I don't have to check or consult anybody's website online. It is what it is. I'm not winking at it. I'm not condoning it, but it is what it is, a yearly tradition. And now that I've gotten to the point in my life where the filter is starting to go, I've got fewer qualms about making comments in public. And a few years ago, I think it was pre-pandemic, I had seen one such young man in his shopping cart. He had about two or three 20-pack rolls of said material. So I said to him, "Son, that's a lot of toilet paper." And he sort of looked at me sheepishly and said, "Well, my mother's not feeling very well." I give him points for being quick on his feet. Now, invariably, when does the festooning of toilet paper in the trees of selected houses take place? At night. Always at night. All the better to conceal the identity of the decorators. Easier to get away with that stuff at night. I've been living here in Plymouth how many years, and I've never seen anybody do this in broad daylight. You'd have to be pretty thick to do stuff like that in broad daylight. But the darkness gives us excellent opportunities to conceal those things which we wish to remain in secret. And that goes well beyond the festooning of trees or toilet paper. Things that we do not wish to have come to scrutiny, we consider putting in the darkness. Peaceful demonstrations take place in broad daylight. Destructive riots take place when? At night, in the cover of darkness. Beware a merchant who hawks their merchandise in poorly lit areas. And we use that phrase, don't we, about things in our personality. We all have them. Habits, inclinations, secrets, things that we do not wish to be known. What do we say? We don't want that stuff to come to light. We don't want the scrutiny. Parts of us are comfortable keeping things under wraps, keeping things in secret, keeping things in the dark. Darkness becomes a comfort to us sometimes. There are things that we do not want to have exposed and brought to the light. And maybe, just maybe, that was a part of Nicodemus's reason for coming to Jesus at night, as he does in John chapter 3. Now here we have Nicodemus. He's a Pharisee. He's a respected leader in Israel. He's one of 70 members of the Sanhedrin, the Jewish ruling council. He's powerful, most likely very wealthy, very influential, very established. And Jesus, on the other hand, is very controversial, very much a person that people feel strongly about one way or the other. And there are certain things, I'm sure, to Nicodemus' reputation that would be in danger if he were to be seen coming to Jesus in broad daylight. And so Nicodemus comes to Jesus that night, comes at a time when it's not easy to be seen, easier to be concealed. That may well be a part of the reason why Nicodemus comes to Jesus at night. But the thing of it is, we as human beings are very complicated. Even under the best of circumstances, we are complicated. Seldom is everything simple for us. We are not persons always of 100% mindset one way or the other. You know, there are parts of us that shade one way or the other. We are ambiguous. And while parts of us may prefer the darkness at times, there's also a part of us that recognizes that darkness is dangerous and we wish to come to the light. Darkness can be disorienting. It causes us to stumble. That can be a dangerous thing, especially in a house loaded full of booby traps. We don't have light. We are apt to to fall, inflict damage on ourselves. And I mean, I've told this story, you know, once upon a time, but in our second apartment when we were living in Chicago, you know, close to how many years, 40 years ago and all of that, I got up in the middle of the night. Things were not well lit. And while I was wandering around, I happened to stumble into the corner of a bookcase with my forehead. Opened up a nice 3/4 to 1 inch gash above my right eye. Now, fortunately, Abby did some very prompt and skillful work with a butterfly bandage, and I wasn't able to, didn't need to have sutures and didn't leave a scar, but it was a reminder that if you're wandering around with your eyes half shut and it's dark out, you can run into trouble rather quickly. And so when it's dark, when we've been used to being in the light and it's dark, we look for sources of light. If the power goes out and we're at home, what do? We look for sources of light. Sometimes it may be a pen light. Sometimes it may be our computers, in the cell phones and all of that. I didn't bring my smartphone with me this morning because, you know, knowing my luck, the phone would ring. And we do have the unofficial cell phone fine kitty around here. It's $5 if your phone goes off in worship. And I've already nicked myself once in the last 10 years. So I'm not doing it again. But oftentimes we'll pull out a flashlight. And then what we do after that? We look for candles, a little bit more permanent sense of light. But when it's dark, we will seek out sources of light to prevent us from stumbling around in the darkness. And maybe, since human beings are complicated and our motives aren't always pure or 100% one way or the other, maybe that's what Nicodemus was about too. Perhaps part of him craved the darkness for the secrecy and the cover that it gave him. But perhaps Nicodemus was tired of stumbling around in the dark. And maybe he saw in Jesus somebody who was a source of light. And maybe coming to Jesus meant that he might have better light in his spiritual life. And so maybe part of the desire for Nicodemus too was a desire to come to the light, a recognition that he has been stumbling around in the darkness for too long. And so Nicodemus and Jesus have that meeting. And Nicodemus puts his cards on the table and he said, "Teacher, we know that you are somebody sent from God, for no one can do the signs that you do unless they have come from God." Then Jesus begins to say that you really can't understand and see the kingdom of God, which the things that the signs are pointing to, unless you are born anew, born from above. And this begins this back and forth dialogue between Nicodemus and Jesus. And Nicodemus, I think for all of his learning and for all of his understanding, is a bit bewildered. He's not sure he can take Jesus at face value on this. There must be a deeper meaning somewhere. Nicodemus says, surely this does not mean that, you know, one climbs back into the womb and is born a second time, does it? And Jesus said that one must be born of water and the Spirit. And this begins to bewilder Nicodemus a little bit. He's not quite sure what it means. And finally he says, how can these things be? And Jesus chides him a little bit. He said, well, you're a teacher of Israel, yet you don't understand these things. And finally, at the end of the conversation, Jesus has shown Nicodemus a good number of things. And I'm not altogether certain that Nicodemus fully understood a good deal of what Jesus was teaching him that night. Yet, I think that little trip into the light, as bright as that was, perhaps maybe even as disorienting as that was, did have a long-term impact on how Nicodemus saw things and how he approached darkness and how he approached light. John's Gospel mentions Nicodemus 3 times. First one is in John chapter 3, where he's kind of the focus of attention in that chapter. The second one happens a little bit later in John chapter 7. Jesus is in Jerusalem for the Feast of the Dedication, what we would call Hanukkah. And the religious authorities are a little bit upset at the things that he's been doing. And they want to quash all of this. And they want to arrest him, put him to trial. And Nicodemus, one of 70 members of the Sanhedrin, questions them on their procedure, on their tradition. He said, is it lawful for us in our tradition that we immediately condemn somebody without a hearing? Nicodemus begins to stand up. Things come to light about him. And this little question, the procedure that Nicodemus brings up, brings to him derision, brings to him mocking. Other members of the council said, are you from Galilee as well? Nobody has ever said that a good prophet will come out of the Galilee. But Nicodemus takes a stand. It may not be a great stand, but he makes a stand on behalf of Jesus. The third time that Nicodemus appears in John's gospel is close to the end. It's in John chapter 19. Jesus is dead on the cross. Joseph of Arimathea, another member of the Sanhedrin, has asked permission of Pontius Pilate to bury the body of Jesus, to give it proper burial. But guess who else shows up at the cross? Nicodemus. Nicodemus has brought with him about 100 pounds of spices for preparation for burial. A very costly gift. Somebody once said this was equivalent of a royal burial. This must have set him back a few dollars to have done something that extravagant. But more importantly, Nicodemus comes to Jesus when? Broad daylight. For every eye to see, for every potential enemy of Jesus to witness, Nicodemus comes to Jesus in broad daylight and professes his allegiance to him at that time and his actions. So you could argue that this brief flash of light in John chapter 3 begins to open up Nicodemus to seek out light and openness in the things that he does later on in John's gospel. And I think maybe it works that way for us too. We also, each and every one of us, are complicated. Our motives are not always 100% one way or the other, not always pure, not always one way or the other. Sometimes in our lives we prefer the cloak of darkness, the secrecy that comes from things that are hidden. There's a part of our lives that likes the darkness for what it hides. But there's also a part of us that desires light as well. I believe that because you're here this morning, either online or in person. You're here when you could have been doing other things. And I think part of that is a desire to come to light and understanding. I think that operates within us as well. And so here we are, desiring to learn more about the kingdom of heaven, wanting to experience in full that being born from anew, that being born by the Spirit. It is not always easy, and like Nicodemus, we sometimes wrestle with the things that Jesus tells us because they are not always easy. I personally do not always find them easy. There are things that stretch us and make us think and cause us to scratch our heads and wonder what it all means. You know, nobody said that whole business of coming to the light was going to be an easy journey. But yet here we are, each of us in our own way, I think, making our pilgrimage from the darkness into the light. And so it is my hope that during these days of Lent especially, God's presence and strength may be with us as we journey into the light, as we begin to try to understand more fully the things of God's kingdom. May God's presence be with us to give us strength. Amen. Those who are able may stand for the singing of hymn number 348, Softly and Tenderly. Announcements and acknowledgments. We have birthdays that we are celebrating this week, and celebrating a birthday today is Carol McElroy, and I know Carol is with us, so happy birthday on your day. Also coming up this week are Jackie Veldman and Morgan Clark, and we wish them happy birthdays in absentia. And I hate to be the bearer of bad news, but we get to put the clocks forward 1 hour next week. So that hour of sleep that you quote-unquote gained in October, you're going to be losing now next week. So anyway, you're forewarned. Thanks to those that helped to make last Wednesday's midweek Lenten experience a good one, and we're going to be continuing the same schedule on this Wednesday as well. The rest of the announcements I would commend to your reading and consideration. We come now to this time where we dedicate our gifts, our tithes, and our offerings. Hear these words as they come to us from the psalmist in Psalm 96, verses 7 and 8. Ascribe to the Lord, O families of the peoples, ascribe to the Lord glory and strength. Ascribe to the Lord the glory due his name. Bring an offering and come into his courts. We will continue with our response, we give thee but thine own. As we prepare to dedicate these gifts. Loving God, we are grateful for the light that has come our way, the light that has come from you. We are thankful that you have brought us to better understanding, and we pray that the gifts here this morning may reflect our gratitude for your light and also the hope that others may come to light as well. And we ask for this in Jesus' name. Amen. Let us now pray that prayer that Christ our Savior has taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you his peace. Amen.
Thank you.